behalf. Lord Jesus, we're humbled by the magnitude of your sacrifice on the cross. Your blood, shed for the forgiveness of our sins, is a testament to your boldness, to your boundless love and grace. Today, as we bring our offerings, we do so with a deep sense of reverence and appreciation for the price you paid to redeem us, Father. In the name of the one whose blood was shed for us, Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, when the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen.
This is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Let's sing that again, church.
This is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Amen. You may be seated.
I have a home eternal home. But for now, I walk this broken world. You walked it first. You know our pain, but you show hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide in me, abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me. There in the night, Gethsemane, before the cross, our suffering and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me.
This morning, I put it up. You know, it covers a multitude of sins. You know, I try to dress differently every week so nobody thinks they've got to dress a certain way. But hey, I might put this on again sometime if I get so many. Wow. Yeah. Anyway, again, just to tell you, my wife is doing well. I have to take her to a couple of doctor visits this week and a couple of tests. Lord willing, I hope she'll be home next week, but I don't know that for sure, so you just keep praying. This morning we're talking about the Duel of the Deceivers. I want to take some of you back to You know, the days when we had magazines, they're almost getting rid of them now, or at least making them all digital. But you go to that little middle section in the magazine, and you'd see something about Mizpah. And you would see things like this. Uncovering the meaning behind the Mizpah coin necklace set, which, of course, you can buy. The Mizpah coin necklace set is a traditional remembrance of love and protection. It has been exchanged between friends and family members for centuries. It represents a bond between two people that will remain unbroken despite being separated by distance or time. No, not at all. This is one of those things where people have taken something out of the Bible and made it mean something it doesn't mean at all. The whole idea of Mizpah in this section that we're going to be looking at today is not a wonderful thing of, hey, let's get together and be friends. No, it's more of a, we're not friends and you better not cross this line. And yet, like I say, it's basically Genesis 31:49 ripped out of its context and made to mean something warm and emotional, and it does not have that meaning at all. Genesis chapter 31, I want to actually go to the end here, and then we'll go back and see why it came to pass that they had this agreement called Mizpah. Verse 49 of chapter 31, and Mizpah, for he said, may the Lord watch between you and me when we are absent from the other. And it's not one of those things, oh, we are friends, and God's going to watch over. No, it's don't you dare cross this line again. This is it. Don't come across, and we are not friends. It was a covenant made between Laban and Jacob, cursing either of them if they crossed the line between them. So how did they come to all of this? Well, let's look at the covenant they made. And I remind you, I'm at the end of the passage. We will go back to the beginning, back in chapter 30 in just a moment. So they got together, verse 44. So come now, let us make a covenant, you and I, and let it be a witness between you and me. Then Jacob took a stone and set it up as a pillar. Jacob said to his kinsmen, gather stones. So they took stones and made a heap, and they ate there by the heap. Now Laban called it Jegar Sahadutha, but Jacob called it Galid. Laban said, this heap is a witness between you and me this day. Therefore it was named Galid, and Mizpah, that is from Jacob's point of view, and Mizpah, for he said, may the Lord watch between you and me when we are absent from the other. If you mistreat my daughters, or if you take wives besides my daughters, although no man is with us, see, God is witness between you and me. Laban said to Jacob, behold this heap, and behold the pillar which I have set between you and me. This heap is a witness, and this pillar is a witness that I will not pass by this heap to you for harm, and you will not pass by this heap and this pillar to me for harm. In other words, I'm not going to come attack you. You're not going to come and attack me. The God of Abraham and the God of Nahor, the God of their father, judge between us. So Jacob swore by the fear of his father Isaac. And then Jacob offered a sacrifice on the mountain and called his kinsmen to the meal. And they ate the meal and they spent the night on the mountain. Early in the morning, Laban arose and kissed his sons and his daughters and blessed them. Then Laban departed and returned to his place. This is the end of the story of really a lot of tension between Laban and Jacob. Laban was Jacob's uncle. Jacob went there to find a wife. He did indeed find one in Rachel, and he thought he was marrying her. But oh no, with a veil on her, it was Leah. Leah, the ugly one, they say. That's not what he intended, but he worked 7 years for her, And then he was so in love with Rachel, he worked another 7 years. And so it's been this thing of just in order to establish his life and to have a wife, wives actually. He worked 14 years, hard work. But the tension got more and more and more difficult until these two men finally had to make this covenant, this pile of rocks between them saying, I'm not going to come attack you. You don't come and attack me. And you have to wonder, how did we come to this? May the Lord watch between you and me when we are absent from the other. May God watch and see if you cross this way and he's going to watch me. We're not going to get together again. Because if we did, we'd probably kill one another, was their thought. And so Mizpah in Hebrew means watch. Kind of like the Lord watch over this spot and curse you if you cross it. And it's not a traditional remembrance of love and protection that you see in the magazines. No, it's a curse on the one who crosses the boundaries that were set up. Why was there this agreement between Jacob and his father-in-law? Because if there hadn't been this agreement, they probably would have gone to battle with one another. And neither of these two deceivers, and they were both deceivers. They were both really scoundrels in the way that they dealt with things. Neither deceiver trusted the other in the conflict. That's one of the reasons they made this covenant together. Now, I want to go back and look at this story now and see why it got so tense and how it is that these two men came to this spot in their lives. So we start with Genesis chapter 30, verse 25. Now it came about when Rachel had born Joseph that Jacob said to Laban, send me away that I may go to my own place and to my own country. And that was a normal thing. He had been with Laban for 14 years. He had worked hard. He had helped with his sheep and all of the cattle that he had. And now he says, I want to go back to my home. I want to go back to the place where God said this would be my meeting place with him, because he had met God at Bethel. God wanted him to return. So he's come to Laban now and said, I want you to send me back. Send me away. Give me my wives and my children for whom I have served you. And let me depart, for you yourself know my service which I have rendered you. I mean, you know, Laban, you've watched me. You've seen what has happened. And listen, folks, you don't make a statement like this to your father-in-law unless it's true. Because this man, Laban, did not trust Jacob at all, but he could not deny the fact that Jacob had worked so hard and that he, Laban, was now richer and had more stock than he had ever had before. And so they come together, and I have to wonder if this is a statement you could make about yourself, about your work ethic. The reason I ask that was because I came across a couple of passages this week in Google about work ethic, because I was looking it up, because obviously here we've got Jacob, great work ethic and so forth. There were so many articles on Generation Z, you know, and that's not Generation Zombie. If you're into the, no. Generation Z follows, the generation before it and followed us and all down the line. It's kind of now the 18 through 25-year-olds that we have. And all of the articles were on how the work ethic with the younger ones just is not there. Some of you have watched it. Some of you have seen it. Here's an article from thehill.com that says the younger generation cannot make this statement about their work ethic. They can't say, oh, we worked hard. We're always there. We caused our employer to have great gains in his employee base and in his finances. No, they can't make that. In fact, the hill says this. Pressed for specifics, employers did not mince words about the younger generation, Generation Z. They think they're better than you, smarter than you, more capable than you, and they will tell you to your face, says Akpan Yukimi, the head of human resources at SGK Global Shipping Services. But they use every excuse they can not to show up for work. Okay, that's pretty interesting. This one comes from those managers, and the managers said they struggle with Generation Z workers for other reasons: lack of motivation, lack of productivity, poor communication skills. I mean, you think about it, the only way younger generation communicates is LOL and this and this and that, you know, all these things, and others which I dare not even quote that they use. Short attention span and excessive sense of entitlement. They believe their employer should set its schedule around their schedule rather than vice versa. For those of us who are older and those of us who work with younger ones, it's a little disheartening. No. I don't change my schedule for your schedule. No. You've got the job. You change your schedule for my schedule. I'm the boss, they think. But they don't want to do that. In fact, they whine often about having to work 40 hours a week. 40 hours a week! I can't work that much. Now, there is somebody in my life that I know well that is this way exactly. And I'm dumbfounded with this sort. He wants the employer to work around his schedule and not vice versa. Wow. But Laban, going back to Laban and Jacob, Laban had to agree that Jacob had been a very hard worker. There was nothing that we have in the history between them that was bad. He worked hard. He increased the flocks for Laban. All of these things. And so Jacob had worked 7 years for Laban to be able to marry Rachel. But you remember, Laban said, I cannot marry off the younger. You have to marry off the older first. So he married Leah before he could even marry Rachel. So he worked basically 14 years altogether. 7 years for Leah, another 7 years for Rachel. And Laban did not want to lose Jacob and his hard work. So he offered him a job. Now get this. At whatever price Jacob wanted to work for. I kind of like deals like that, wouldn't you? Man. Not that he kept his agreement, but that was what he offered him. Notice what it says in verse 27. Laban said to him, if now it pleases you, stay with me. I have divined that the Lord has blessed me on your account. He continued, name me your wages and I will give it. Sounds pretty good. Now, if you are following along this morning and you have an older translation, you may read, I have experienced that the Lord has blessed me on your account. But the Hebrew word that is used here doesn't mean that. It means to divine. It means to get from some occultic situation a truth that you didn't know. And so the verse literally says, I have divined that the Lord, Yahweh, that was the God that Jacob worshipped. I have learned through occultic means that Yahweh has blessed me on your account. So I'd like to keep you. So Laban's God, false God obviously, revealed to him that Jacob was worth keeping. And you might be surprised how Laban compared his God with Jacob's God. I mean, they're talking, yeah, your God and your God and... What is this? What kind of setting is this that these two men are talking about different gods among one another? What goes on here? I need to give you a little bit of background because most of us have not been taught this. And you need to understand the religious background of Jacob's day. Let me take you back to Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 8 and 9. This is talking about the Tower of Babel. When the Most High gave the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of man, he set the boundaries of the people according to the number of the, and if you read most translations, it says the sons of Israel. But that's not really what the original says at all. In fact, you go back to the Masoretic text and it says the sons of God. If you've been with me for very long, you know that the sons of God usually is a phrase used for fallen angels or for demonic forces, for spirit beings. So he says that God separated all the nations of the world according to the number of the sons of Israel. Nope, the sons of God. In other words, God said to the fallen angels, the members who had followed Satan and so many others, he said, this nation is yours, this nation is yours, this nation is yours. You remember when in Daniel, when the angel Gabriel was not able to get to Daniel because he said, I was opposed by the prince of Persia. The prince of Persia would have been one of those fallen angels that was governing that area of the world. And so God put all the nations of the world under the fallen angels. I know you look at me like, I've never heard of that before. I know. I hadn't either. Except for maybe the past 5 years or so, we've began to discover some of this. Look at verse 9. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the allotment of his inheritance. In other words, at the Tower of Babel, after that was over and God judged those people, he gave all the nations of the world to the fallen deities, and his people were the Jews only. Now, with that in mind, you've got an awful lot of people worshiping gods from all over the place other than the one true God. The sons of God were over all the nations of the world. Yahweh God was over all of the tribes of Israel. With that in mind, the world was divided among the false gods and the one true God. If this is the first time you've heard it, just kind of put it in the back of your mind. We'll talk about it another time. Psalm 96, verse 4 says, For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. And you go, huh? There are no other gods. Yeah, there are, but not in the way you think. It says, great is Yahweh, greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all Elohim. You say, well, but God of the Bible is Elohim. Yes, he is. God of the Bible is Elohim, and all spirit beings mentioned in the Old Testament are Elohim as well. For all the Elohim of the people are idols, but the Lord, Yahweh, made the heavens. In other words, there's only one Yahweh, only one God, only one Elohim Yahweh, but there are plenty of other spirit beings around, but that doesn't make them gods like we worship our one eternal God. No. They're called gods. But they're not the same as Yahweh God. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the Apostle Paul tells us, what do I mean then? That a thing sacrificed to idols is anything? Or that an idol is anything? No. But I say that the things which Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. What I want you to understand is that around the world, yes, there are plenty of other gods, little g, but they are not the one true God. And they try and they try and they try to get people to follow them. But the one true God is going to set up his son over all of this world and give him the inheritance which is his, and that is the kingdom of God. With that in mind, for Laban to talk about his God was no different today than I'm maybe talking with you. And I'm Catholic, you're Protestant, I'm Episcopalian, you're Baptist, I worship idols, you worship Yahweh. In the same sentence, that didn't bother them because they realized that there was that distinction. And so Laban's information was from a false god. And his false god told him, you know this guy Jacob? I'd keep him around. He's done good work for you. Oh yeah, he doesn't worship us. But we might could get him to worship us if we have him with us enough. Verse 27, Laban said to him, if now it pleases you, Jacob, stay with me, for I have divined that the Lord has blessed me on your account. He continued, name me your wages and I'll give it. Again, sounds like a great deal. Now each of these two deceivers begin to bargain and to see what they could get out of the situation. I apologize, this is a long passage, but it's important that we read through it for you to understand what's going on. He, Jacob, said to him, you yourself know how I have served you and how your cattle have fared with me. For you had little before I came, and it has increased to a multitude, and the Lord has blessed you wherever I turned. But now, when shall I provide for my own household also? In other words, hey, I'm a grown man now. I want to go with my family and establish my family, my kinship, and so forth. The Lord has blessed you wherever I turn. But now, when shall I provide for my own household? So he said, what shall I give you? And Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. Now that ought to strike you as strange. Okay, I'm going to give you whatever you want for your wages. And Jacob says, oh no, you don't need to give me anything. If you will do this one thing for me. Now again, you see the two deceivers kind of coming after each other to see who can win this battle. Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. If you'll do this one thing for me, I will again pasture and keep your flocks. Let me pass through your entire flock today, removing from there every speckled and spotted sheep and every black one among the lambs and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and such shall be my wages. In other words, you keep the pure sheep, I'll get the spotted ones, the ones that are not seen as, you know, all that great. That'll be my wages. So my honesty will answer for me later when you come concerning my sheep, my flock, my wages. And so that's what they put together between them. The spotted sheep were taken to Laban's sons. Pure sheep were left with Jacob to raise for Laban. Now here's the deal. The spotted ones he takes out because if he keeps the spotted ones there, there will be more spotted ones to, you know, reproduce for Jacob. Laban doesn't want that to happen. So the spotted sheep are taken to Laban's sons. The pure sheep are left with Jacob to raise for Laban. And then we have this very strange thing going on where Laban takes the poplar and the ash trees and he puts little lines in them and so forth. And the sheep, when they come to mate, well, lo and behold, you got a whole lot more spotted ones than you do the other. So you got lots of spotted sheep for Jacob and a few pure looking sheep for Laban. The question, how'd this work? And you can read commentary after commentary. You can read articles on, yes, there's a very scientific thing to this, although having read those, I can't see any science in this. He puts up these poles and you get more spotted sheep or more speckled sheep or more this, that, and the other. What's happening is every time Laban comes down, he says, oh, you get all these spotted sheep and I get these few pure sheep. Well then, hey, this time it's going to be different. I'm going to change the whole thing with your wages, and next time you get the speckled sheep or whatever. But it doesn't matter how many times Laban changes things, Jacob is getting more and more and more. And by the way, Laban's sheep were taken away 3 days' distance from the original sheep. So there's no way this could work other than, in my opinion, it's just a blessing of the Lord. You can believe there's some scientific animal husbandry thing behind this so that you get different kinds of sheep, but that's not the way it happened. Every time Laban changed it, God changed it. So I think he was the one involved in this and just blessed Laban. Spotted sheep were multiplying for Jacob over and over and over, and very few for Laban. So Jacob is getting very, very rich. Genesis 31, verse 1. Now Jacob heard the words of Laban's sons. He's out doing his work for Laban, and the sons are talking, saying, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's, and from what belonged to our father, he has made all this wealth. Jacob saw the attitude of Laban, and behold, it was not friendly toward him as formerly. Laban can't figure this thing out. Even though he keeps changing the wages and how it's done, Laban is getting fewer sheep, and Jacob is getting so many more. Now, for the sons to say that's just wrong. Jacob had taken nothing but according to the agreement. Everything he did was according to that agreement, but he was increasing more than Laban, and they were envious. How can this be? And they're getting really hot mad. And Jacob is beginning to see the danger in his staying there. In the next passage, Yahweh, Jacob's God, one true God, told him to return to the promised land. Here's where we read it. The Lord said to Jacob, return to the land of your fathers and to your relatives, and I will be with you. So Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah, his two wives, to his flock in the field and said to them, I see your father's attitude. It's not friendly toward me as formerly, but the God of my father has been with me. You know that I have served your father with all my strength, yet your father has cheated me and changed my wages 10 times. However, God did not allow him to hurt me. If he spoke thus, quote, the speckled shall be your wages, then all the flock brought forth speckled. If he spoke thus, the striped shall be your wages, then all the flock brought forth striped. Thus God has taken away your father's livestock and given them to me. And it came about at the time when the flock were mating that I lifted up my eyes and saw in a dream, and behold, the male goats which were mating were striped, speckled, and mottled. Then the angel of the Lord came to me in a dream. Jacob, I said, here I am. He said, lift up now your eyes and see that all the male goats which are mating are striped, speckled, and mottled. For I have seen all that Laban has been doing to you. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed a pillar, where you made a vow to me. Now, arise, leave this land. The angel of the Lord tells him, Jacob, I'm the one that's been working this out. Every time your wages were changed to whether they were speckled or spotted or anything else, then I made sure those were the ones who through the mating became part of yours. I've overcome Laban's sheep to give them to you. And so we read, and return to the land of your birth. Rachel and Leah said to him, do we still have any portion or inheritance in our father's house? Are we not reckoned to him by him as foreigners? For he has sold us and has also entirely consumed our purchase price. Surely all the wealth which God has taken away from our father belongs to us and our children. Now then, do whatever God has said to you. Jacob, our father has cheated us in all of this. He's made us like we're not even his children. He's taken everything that could have been our inheritance. So we'll go with you. This is a good idea. We're going to follow. So Rachel and Leah were aware of the fact that their father was a devious and crooked man, so they were happy to leave with Jacob, who was a devious and crooked man. I mean, what do you say? However, I want you to notice that he's beginning to change. He's beginning to learn what God is doing for him. So verse 17, Jacob arose and put his children and his wives upon camels. You know what that tells us? He's a rich man if he can find that many camels to take his wives and his children. That was a sign of great wealth besides the other animals that he had. And all his property which he had gathered, his acquired livestock which he had gathered in Padan Aram to go to the land of Canaan to his father Isaac. When Laban had gone to shear his flock, then Rachel stole the household idols that were her father's. Now, why does she do that? Why does Rachel steal the idols of her father? I have to tell you, we don't know for sure. There are a lot of speculations. Some say she may have wanted them because she had been raised to worship them. Or some say she may have been trying to keep her father from idolatry. Whatever you say about it, we don't know why she stole them. But there was a little bit of getting back at her father in doing this. So whatever the situation, Laban should have learned by now the worthlessness of his idols. They didn't protect him from anything. They told him to do this. They told him to hire Jacob and do these things. And it turned around and bit him. These idols that he worshipped did nothing for him. So then we read, and Jacob deceived Laban the Aramean by not telling him that he was fleeing. So he fled with all that he had, and he arose and crossed the Euphrates River and set his face toward the hill country of Gilead. He's going to do what his God told him to do. So even though God had commanded Jacob and the family to move back to the land of promise, Jacob is setting out. He's still trying to do it his deceiving ways. Okay, I'm not going to let Laban know about this. I'm going to go in the middle of the night. He's 3 days away from me. I can do this. He just can't quite get over this thing of trying to help God out, which we talked about last week. So Jacob, at this part in his life, is facing danger from two people. Yeah, he's facing danger from Laban, but also from Esau. When he leaves Laban in this area where he had lived and where he had gotten all of his flocks, and he moves out from there, he now has to face Esau, his brother, who at last, he had heard, wanted to kill him. It's quite a story. But we read, when it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob had fled, then he took his kinsman with him and pursued him a distance of 7 days' journey, and he overtook him in the hill country of Gilead. God came to Laban the Aramean in a dream of the night and said to him, now let's stop here. Which God is this? Is this his God? Is this Yahweh God? I take it, it must be Yahweh God because of what he says to him. Be careful that you do not speak to Jacob either good or bad. That's not what his God would have said. So he goes, he finds Jacob. And remember that Laban already had a distance of 3 days away from Jacob. So he's got some time to make up. So he gets his group together and they go out hunting for his son-in-law. And apparently, Laban had some evil intentions for Jacob. He apparently was going to kill him. But God appearing to him in the middle of the night says, no, don't you dare do that. You don't speak a word of ill to him. Well, he'd been caught up with Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the hill country, and Laban with his kinsmen camped in the hill country of Gilead. Then Laban said to Jacob, what have you done by deceiving me and carrying away my daughters like captives of the sword? Why did you flee secretly and deceive me and did not tell me so that I might have sent you away with joy and with songs, liar, liar, pants on fire, with timbrel and with lyre, and did not allow me to kiss my sons and my daughters? By the way, sons is a word which can mean sons or sons, grandsons, great-grandsons. So they would have been his grandsons. Now you have done foolishly. It's in my power to do you harm. But the God of your father spoke to me last night, saying, be careful not to speak either good or bad to Jacob. Now what's this all about? Notice the tactics that Laban uses here. First of all, he tries to shame Jacob. Now you have done foolishly. Here's the older one saying to the younger, how could you be so foolish to do this? I might have sent you away with joy and songs. This could have been a better outcome, Jacob. And then Laban tries to threaten him. It's in my power to do you harm, but your God told me not to. Why did you steal my gods? Ooh, now we get to this. What do you mean, steal your gods? Jacob didn't know about the gods. They were called the teraphim. It just means the household gods. He didn't know about that. He had no idea that Rachel had taken them. But here are these two deceivers trying to feel each other out and gain an advantage through all of this. Then Jacob replied to Laban, because I was afraid, for I thought that you would take your daughters from me by force. The one with whom you find your God shall not live. In other words, you can look through all the stuff we've got here. I don't have your stuff. I don't have your teraphim. If you find out who it was, we'll kill them. The one with whom you find your God shall not live. In the presence of our kinsmen, point out what is yours among my belongings and take it for yourself. For Jacob did not know that Rachel had stolen them. Now we read. Excuse me. Rachel had taken the household idols and put them in the camel's saddle, and she sat on them. And Laban fell through all the tent, but he didn't find them. She said to her father, let not my lord be angry, but I cannot rise before you, for the manner of women is upon me. So he searched, but did not find the household idols. She was sitting on them. Now Jacob responds to Laban, and he's ticked off. He's really upset. Then Jacob became angry and contended with Laban. And Jacob said to Laban, what is my transgression? What is my sin that you have hotly pursued me? Though you have felt through, oops, one time too many there. Let's go back. Hate it. You just do one thing. You felt through all my goods. What have you found of all your household goods? Set it here before my kinsmen and your kinsmen that they may decide between us two. These 20 years I've been with you, your ewes, your female goats have not miscarried, nor have I eaten the ram of your flocks. That which was torn of beasts, I did not bring it to you. I bore the loss of it myself. You required it of my hand, whether it was stolen by... I just keep hitting it one time too many. So I've been off. Not quite the same. You won't hold it against me, will you? Since now I don't know where I am. Oh, it's got to be there somewhere. That doesn't look like it. Go down to verse 42. If the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had not been for me, surely now you would have sent me away empty-handed. God has seen my affliction and the toil of my hand, so he rendered judgment last night. In other words, I've beaten you. Skip down to verse 49. And Mizpah. For he said, may the Lord watch between you and me when we are absent from one another. And that brings us to the end of the story. The story being, these deceivers have so gone against each other, trying to win in their own way. But it really is God. God is the one behind this. God is the one who saw to it that Jacob would increase. Verse 54, then Jacob offered a sacrifice on the mountain and called his kinsmen to the meal, and they ate the meal and spent the night on the mountain. Early in the morning, Laban arose, kissed his sons and his daughters, and blessed them. Then Laban departed and returned to his place. We've gotten rid of one of the deceivers in this story. Now, Jacob's life is the story of a man learning how to get along with others. He's trying to figure out from his deceptive point of view, how do I deal with Uncle Laban? How do I deal with his very angry sons? How do I deal with people? And I think, you know, this is a good thing for us to look at ourselves. How good are you at getting along with others? Some of you may have a very hateful, deceiving uncle whoever. Or how do you learn to get along with the people who are in your group? What do you need to work on in getting along with others? Most of us are old enough now, we don't even remember back what we did or how it happened. But those of us who've lived longer have seen you don't deal with people this way. You deal with them this way. And you learn to do it in a way so that you actually benefit the people around you. Well, if you don't know how to get along with people, I've got some good news for you. You need to get a Mizpah charm. Mm-hmm. That's right, $39.95 plus shipping and handling. If you can't find it in a magazine, call me. I'll be glad to do it for $49.95. WikiHow.org tells you how to get along with people. First of all, it says, be a good listener. Don't try to change them. Keep your sense of humor. Now, don't you feel good about that? Wow, now I can get along with people. Or peoplebuilders.com says, get to know others. Get to know yourself. Develop communication skills. Oh boy, my life has been changed greatly by these two websites. But you know what? There's a biblical answer. It's such a simple answer, and we've gone through a long story to get to it, but the biblical answer is this. Proverbs 16:7. When a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. You know the obvious question here. Do my ways please the Lord? Am I learning to live a life according to what he has laid out in his word? Not lying to people, being gracious, overlooking things that are done to me that I might benefit others. All of these things go back to when a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord. He makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. That's a supernatural answer. You're dealing with some tough people in your life. You're dealing with some Labans, or maybe even some Jacobs on the spiritual side, and you don't know how to deal with them. Please the Lord. Know from his book the way that he has taught you for years and years. You've come to church, you've listened, you've heard. Now, deal with it. Live that way so that even your enemies will be at peace with you. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me now. Father, right now we come before you and ask that you might help us to learn to be at peace with all who are around us. Like you told us through the Apostle Paul, that we're to show the love of God in everything that we do, that we're to put others first. And I pray, Father, that you would help us in that process to learn to obey you and please you so that we might be your people exhibiting your love in this world. Lord, I know a lot of us come to church and we're told, don't do this, do this, don't do that. And Father, we kind of store it away and put it away. I pray this morning that you might help us to see it's not worth storing away and putting away. It's the things from your word that tell us how to live with people who are hard to live with. And I pray, Father, that you would teach us once again to honor you so that even our enemies are at peace with us. And you've told us, Lord, to, as much as is possible, to be at peace with our enemies, to show them love and concern so that you might work supernaturally through our getting together with them. Father, if there's someone here this morning who doesn't know you as his Savior, as her Redeemer, I pray that you might help them to understand through this message or some that we've talked about in the last few weeks that you want to work through our lives, but that can only happen when we become children of God. If there's someone here this morning, Father, who doesn't know you, I pray that your Holy Spirit would cause them to understand that your Son died for them, did for them what they could not do for themselves, to make heaven their home. I pray that your Holy Spirit would lead them to the Savior this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Second sermon. You'll learn a whole lot more from your mistakes if you're not so busy denying them. Just a thought.
Let's stand and sing. But before we do that, if you've got questions about the church, salvation, or you need prayer, we've got deacons in the back and deacons in the front to pray with you. Let's go ahead and sing together.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. You have a blessed Sunday. We'll see you next week.